of a sudden, they just went out of their cars and came advancing towards us. The first white policeman threw a tear gas. It was the first time we saw a tear gas can. We didn't know even what it was. So when we saw it emitting smoke, we dispersed. And when we came back again. Maybe we thought they would talk to us through a loudspeaker or something like that. All of a sudden, the same policeman who threw the tear gas canister opened fire on the students. I saw a boy of about 11 going down under police fire. I could not believe it. Apparently, when Hector was shot, the students ran back. And I was left with Hector and a girl. I was feeling scared and I wanted to run away too. And this policeman was aiming his gun at Hector again, wanting to finish him off. And this girl stood in front of Hector and told the policeman in Afrikaans that skit for me, shoot for me. And the policeman deviated his aim and shot in the air.
Was there any attempt at communication between you as the leader of the students, or one of the leaders of the students, and the police force?
There wasn't no communication at all.
Were there any loud hailers or anything like that?
It wasn't there to start with. I did not see one, and nobody saw one, if there was any. The only type of communication I saw was just bullets and tear gas.
There was so much noise the whole night, and we could hear that there was noise in the police station too. Everybody was kept moving.
But what sort of noise? What?
You know, the kind of noise that sort of displayed an atmosphere of jubilation, you know, a Christmas Eve or a New Year's Eve. In fact, this is what I said, because people suddenly said, but why is there so much noise outside? Some people said, it's the taxis. I said, taxis at this time of the night? Can't you hear the hooting, you know, sounds like a jubilation of a Christmas Eve or a New Year's Eve? And then when we got out, the interpretation we were given was that, well, the students were only asking everybody to approve of their action. So people were excited, they were shouting pa, if you had a car you had to hoot, and there was all that noise, which said to me, while there was a lot of shooting going on, the people were determined to continue their action, because this noise never stopped until dawn.
I know for a fact that there were more than 300 people who were dead.
How do you know that?
After the June riots, on the weekend after the Wednesday, we went to the government mortuary to go and try and find some people and identify the people we know. When we got there, there were bodies scattered all over the place, and some of them were packed like potato sacks. And apparently these people had name tags on their wrists, and these name tags had been removed because you could see where the plaster was. And then they had been pasted with numbers on their foreheads.
This is the corpses?
The corpses. And they were turning bluish in color. I don't know what was the cause of that. And the biggest figure I saw was 353.
That's from the numbers on the corpses themselves?
The numbers on the corpses themselves. There is an instance where I saw a child of 8. When this hippo passed, people ran away. And this kid innocently raised his fist in a black power sign and said, power to this passing hippo. The hippo stopped there on the spot and they opened fire on this 8-year kid. When I went to the mortuary on the weekend, I saw this kid at the mortuary. She was riddled with bullets beyond recognition.
At the moment, it is no longer just a student thing. The students are in action, okay? They are taking the lead, but they have majority of the adult behind them now. Everybody keeps saying, what's the point of stopping now? Did we have to have so many people dying? Are we fair to the dead? You know, you begin to curse yourself if you can still be a coward, because you feel many have died for you. Why not go ahead? And people are actually saying, if we drop it now, then we'll never pick it up.
The South African state is built on institutionalized racial discrimination. Almost no blacks may live in white cities, so each city has its black township outside. Soweto, the largest, houses over 1 million blacks who can be transported daily the 12 miles in and out of Johannesburg as long as their cheap labor is needed. No blacks may own. It was not surprising that it was in Soweto, the biggest township, that the first signs of rebellion came. And after Soweto's children were shot, dozens of other townships erupted in protest all over South Africa. In Soweto itself, new adult leaders emerged, sympathetic to the students and understanding their militancy. Dr. Manas Buthelezi.
Does the generation of parents of these youngsters now feel that they should have fought harder and earlier, and that they've accepted too much for too long?
Not necessarily. I believe that parents or the generation of the grown-ups have done all they could given the conditions under which they operated. You will remember that there's a basic difference between this younger generation and the generation of their parents, in that these students are the products of Bantu education. Most of us were raised in an educational system which, even though it had its own shortcomings, but took as a presupposition a common South African society. So you were educated in order to fit in this common society. Maybe that this delayed some of us in getting out of positions of unreality and becoming more realistic, but it is a fact that that was what was operating. But these students have been raised in the framework of Bantu education, where they have been told that they are being educated for a place in their own community, a place which is politically circumscribed through the policy of separate development. And it is against this background that their reaction should be seen, in contrast to that of the parents.
The black student in South Africa is being fed the type of education that will will domesticate him to become a better tool for the white man when he joins the working community. School libraries, school books, they've got nothing to do with civics or anything that is affiliated in any manner to politics. What happens is we are fed a lot of fiction stories. I could quote so many authors in fictitious writers that you would be surprised where I get them. Even our libraries are ill-equipped. You don't get much works on, say, democracy, communism, fascism, capitalism, and all that. We only know these things as concepts and something not within our world.
It's more than likely, Tsietsi, that you're being described up and down the country at the moment as a communist.
There is no truth in that as far as I'm concerned. It is just that in South Africa, if you're not doing what the government expects you to do, then you are a communist, of course.
Does this now mean, as a result of this recent action, that there is no real credibility remaining in the institutions which were set up by the government previously? I'm talking now about the urban Bantu councils and so on. Are they discredited?
As far as the black community is concerned, there has never been any credibility in government-created institutions. I think even the homeland leaders have, from time to time, said this, that they don't believe in the system which the government has placed them, but for practical reasons, they hope perhaps that they can elicit something out of the situation. It is not as if that they believe that there was credibility in the structures.
But now the whole structure surely is completely discredited, utterly discredited.
I would agree to that. Up to now, there is a situation of deadlock. When we approached the minister and told him that students had approached us and had asked us to convey to him their grievances, he put very difficult conditions.
This is Mr. Kruger, the Minister
yes,
of Justice.
Yes, Minister of Justice. That we must first prove that we are leaders by stopping the disturbances.
Rather than listen to the new black leaders, Kruger has jailed no less than half the executive of the Black Parents Association.
It appears as if all the leadership that has emerged outside the framework of separate development has been subjected to these detentions and bannings.
Under those circumstances, then, how can Mr. Kruger expect anybody to come forward and talk for the community if they're all in his jails?
I'm also asking the same question.
As we interviewed Tsietsi Mashinini, the news came in of how successful the students' plan had been.
It makes me very happy, very happy.
What is it actually achieving, though?
The idea is, we blacks in South Africa do not have arms, and the only thing we can hit at the system with is just to cripple the economy of the country and make our faint cries reach the ears of the authorities. Because apparently if we demonstrate, they just shoot at us. and if they don't shoot, they detain a whole lot of students. Now we are trying to be as peaceful as possible. Detain the parents at home, and the parents are with us, and they are prepared to stay at home as long as the students want them to stay at home. Now, with this, we believe the authorities will feel the pinch, and some way or the other, they'll have to succumb to our demands.
The police concern was understandable. The strike call revealed how swiftly the student campaign had escalated. Their pamphlet read, "For the scrapping of Bantu education, the release of prisoners detained during the demos, and the overthrow of oppression, we, the students, call on our parents to stay at home and not go to work from Monday. Our slogan is, away with Forster, down with oppression, power to the people."
Do you think that any government readjustments in policy now are really going to affect the situation, or has it got to be something much more substantial?
What is needed is not just a readjustment in the details of the policy, but a change of policy altogether. I think that's what is needed. In other words, separate development is not a solution, it is a problem.
The system has done so many things and so much harm to my people that the people are no longer interested in having equal rights with the white people in South Africa. They want the tables to be turned so that the white man can get a taste of his own medicine and feel what it was like to be oppressed.
Are they liable to shoot you on sight?
Oh yes, sure. What Colonel Fesser has been doing is he went to the Black Parents Association members and told them that he has got official and positive reports that I have a machine gun in my hand. Now, as far as I see it, he has just been trying to create an atmosphere where I can be declared a dangerous element so that when they meet me, they don't want to take me to court and be involved in a lot of legal intricacies. They just want to shoot me on sight and get over with it.
Have you ever considered that the winning of this battle against a regime, against a system, against an ethic which is so powerfully armed is a battle that you might not win?
No! That's the mistake even the white people make in this country. You know, a battle is not won by guns only. There is the moral aspect of it. There is the strategic point of it. The buildings in Soweto and all over still went down despite the guns. You know, today we think that in Soweto people are just sitting down and not going to work. So if the black people can recognize their power, they can win this battle. Are they really going to push us out of our houses, all of us with their guns, to go to work? And they are aware of this. They can only get at with their bullets if we go dancing or doing things in the streets. But if we shut ourselves in our houses, what will happen? We are the labor force of this country, and people are becoming aware, because every confrontation says find a new strategy.
Are you going to be in danger by talking to me about this?
It all depends, because they have all this loss where they can, you know, do something to you without actually bringing you to the courts of justice. And such laws are meant even perhaps for this kind of interview. They can use the Internal Security Act, move me out, then I can talk to you next time. They could even use, you know, the Terrorism Act, knowing that they would never charge me but keep renewing the 180 days. Or they can even use the Suppression of Communism Act, ban me so that I can never even move out of my area of residence and I cannot meet people at meetings, because by a meeting it could be defined as just you talking to the next person. Two people constitute a meeting. So they've got many other laws they could use against us.
Are you expecting to be detained yourself?
Yes, certainly. By virtue of being a member of SAS, or especially a staff member, detention is just part of the sequence.
What has been the reaction of the authorities to the situation since June the 16th?
They are convinced that SAS and BPC, SAS are behind the whole thing. And this is why they are desperately harassing and detaining members and leaders, with the hope of bringing the situation under control, as they always say.
But what are they actually doing that? Are they bringing it under control?
Far from it. Far from it, because it's an undeniable fact that it's not SAS or not BPC. Neither outside agitators or what they always say, but it's the black community expressing dissatisfaction.
Have any of your friends been beaten up, or how have they been treated by the police, people that you know about?
Oh, terribly. Terribly. The treatment has been terrible. Both women and men prisoners, they go to the extent of putting them under electric pressure, electric shocks. I know of a woman friend of mine who was in prison recently after the Frelimo Morales, who was made to stand on dry ice, bucket full of dry ice on barefoot. Very terrible. Some of them being starved, and I'm sure you know about the recent one who died in detention. Yeah. That's one of our leaders.
What's going to happen to you personally in the next 2 years?
One thing I know is that I'm going to jail. To be detained, but it depends how long one is going to be detained. It's very difficult for me to make a program for after detention, because this latest clause is that you get detained indefinitely.
That's what you're expecting?
Definitely. It's inevitable.
Do you think that a complete clampdown, that hard, severe measures, ruthless as possible, will have any particular effect on the movement, the black consciousness movement?
Not at all. The only thing that can quell the black consciousness movement is to ban them. That is the movement themselves. But then the movements are not card-carrying members and so on. It's the ideology and the message. And at this stage, I must say Kruger is very late, because the message has been carried across. And every black member of the community is receptive to that, and it means they are all members, which means you must imprison everybody and ban everybody, or even kill everybody, maybe one piece.
Do you see a lot of bloodshed in the future?
I should think so, yes. I mean, I've witnessed bloodshed for the first time in my life during the past few months. I know about Sharpeville, I know about the other incidents. But then now that I've seen it, I've realized that it's a very easy thing.
We have to realize, as black people, that the white people will never give us our liberation on the plate. So they may even shoot us, you know, in an uncalled for manner. And this we have to recognize will happen. Someone will suffer, and it will be unfair to put someone in the front line and you remain in the back line. So we have to accept it. Even if it strikes my child, I must be content to take it.
Realistically, looking at what you are up against, is it not a possibility somewhere in the back of your mind that this might be a futile struggle?
I don't think so. Whatever happens, the black people shall achieve what they want. We are aware that it is a long struggle, but in the very near future, we will be what we want to be.
Tsietsi Mashinini, in fear of his life, fled to exile the night we interviewed him. Mrs. Phakathi was arrested by 11 security men the morning after speaking to us. Under Section 10 of the Internal Security Act, she is now detained indefinitely without trial. Deborah Matshoba was detained under the same act 2 days ago. Dr. Manus Buthelezi is still waiting for the government to open talks with him.